technical hitch, don't you? Okay, guys. So this is Threads from the Refugee Crisis. This image in the front cover of the book is of a US plane bombing a Médecins Sans Frontières hospital in Afghanistan. And the actual cover is just a really nice piece of sequential art done by the cover designer, not me, where I actually show kind of the cause and effect of what and why refugees are, which isn't something that I discuss anywhere else in the book in great detail, because basically what the story is the story of when I went to Calais and what I saw there. It's graphic reportage. And what I like about graphic reportage is when you visit a place or a situation, there's something specific and unique about that place that you couldn't get if you weren't actually there on the ground. So this is me visiting Calais. This is the city of Calais. This is like the establishing shot, if you will. And the first thing we see is white fences stream along the highway, meters high, miles long. The smooth steel lacework glistens in the evening sun. So I discovered when I visited Calais that that lace is the traditional craft of the town. And that gave me a wonderful metaphor and a beautiful visual image to use for the rest of my work. Calais, the city was famous for its lace making, the meticulous toil of women and girls sitting outside to make the most of the daylight, nimble fingers, bobbins dancing, continuously twisting the threads. So I use this lace throughout the book as my borders. And in fact, I've got all my borders of lace saved as a file on my computer with the title No Borders. But I felt like the book needed something kind of beautiful. I was probably also inadvertently referencing the work of Linda Barry in her book 100 Demons, where she uses a lot of collage in her work. The jungle, it's massive. Oh my, I don't know what I thought I'd see, but I didn't expect this. So many people, so much need. A microcosmic disunited nations. Over here is Afghanistan. Over there is Sudan, Eritreans, Syrians, Iraqis. Now, immediately you can see that you can fit so much into a comic in the terms of just labeling stuff and pointing stuff out that you would need so many more words to do without the images. Politicians call them a flood, but of the millions of people around the world fleeing for their lives, this is just a trickle. Maybe 5,000 human beings? Nobody knows exactly. Nobody is counting. These people don't count. Everywhere there's an air of expectation of impermanence. People who've been on the move for so long are stuck in limbo, tantalizingly close to their destination, but they're wrong, the wrong side of those cruel fences, still so very far. There are a lot of smiles, which I didn't expect. Everywhere, little interactions, points of connection, life threads crossing. Incidentally, the artwork at the beginning of this book is really chunky because the material conditions in which I created it is that it was like my kids had a week holiday. I had, like, including the weekends, 9 days to draw the cartoon, and I didn't have any childcare, and I just stuck them in front of YouTube, and I just drew 16 pages in 9 days. And usually it takes me 2 days to draw a page of comic. So then when I went back and reworked this initial comic, this initial 16-page comic into the first chapter of the book, I always thought, well, should I redraw it? And then I decided not to, because I thought it sort of suits the subject matter that the artwork is a bit sketchy. Today, we're helping to build shelters with a limited number of hammers. 8-foot square plastic shacks is better than a tent. You want a house? These are for the women and children. Come back tomorrow. He turns away. He knows tomorrow never comes. My white privilege grants me the job of guarding the tool tent. We can give out a small handful of nails. I just want a lock. It's not up to me. He's worked all day, but I can't give it to him. We have 3 padlocks in a box and thousands of people wanting them. However pointless it may be, locking the door of a dwelling when you can slit the sides with a Stanley knife, everyone wants to feel secure. Shabab is here alone. He's 12, the same age as my son. He's growing up far too fast. He doesn't look sad, but I never see him smile either. We help him build his house. He's competent with a hammer. and over-enthusiastic with a staple gun. My son wouldn't know how to use a hammer unless it was on Minecraft. I give him some grapes out of a maternal concern for his vitamin intake. I feel an urge to scold him for treading down the backs of his shoes, but then I realise that everyone does it. It's a sandal-wearing culture. That'll change when winter starts to bite. So this is part of a report from a specific period in time. Just one weekend, I went to Calais, I saw some stuff, I came back, I had to draw this. It felt like it vomited out of me. And it got some interesting reactions. This cartoon could not be better propaganda for battlefield veteran Islamic militant males invading Northern Europe if Lenin himself produced it. The situation would not exist if they very people breaking laws in Calais did not ruin their homelands with ethnic religious hatred, intolerance and war. You are importing death. Well, I quite like this feedback that arrived on my website after I put my blog post up and it got reblogged and it went viral. Because for someone to have honestly reacted to my report of what I saw like this, for them to have this visceral reaction, like this was never someone I was going to convert. But for this person to have seen my work, there must have been a whole other bunch of people in the middle who didn't already know about what was happening to refugees in Northern France, and yet who didn't, you know, I must have reached a lot of people to have found this person. And obviously it shows something of the power of comics, which I sought to capitalize on by printing 15,000 comics and distributing them for refugee relief. This is 15,000 comics in my front room of my house. And this is my cat. And this is my beer cupboard. So I had to distribute all the comics before I could get to my beer. So that was quite a good incentive. And this here is mess because I don't believe that it's possible to be a graphic novelist and a mother and have a tidy house. Maybe somebody else can prove me wrong. I'll lay down the challenge. So that wasn't the only time I went to Calais. I went back two other times and there was other things that I wanted my art to do when I was there. So one of the things that I did was I took a sketchbook with me and I drew portraits of people and I gave them to people because it's a weird situation. You've got people who are stuck one side of a national border and then you had loads of English people, British people going and Irish people going over and spontaneously helping, help quote unquote helping, but actually effectively the most helpful thing we could have done would have been to just stuff someone in the back of the car, drive them back, because what they were trying to do was get to the UK. Instead, you're over there distributing toothpaste and socks. So it felt like if I draw a picture of someone, it's a way of recognizing their humanity. So this is hanging out in the youth center, which was built in Calais. This is all unaccompanied migrant kids between the ages of 12 and 17. It's an intimate thing to do, to draw a portrait, to sit and study every feature of a face. The impossibly thick eyelashes. Incidentally, look, I can draw better than that first bit. The soft downy hair growing on the upper lip. The strangely massive Afghan hands. They all had hands like plates of meat, honestly. The kids' ears are slightly furry too, very small and rounded. They look padded. I idly wonder if he has his mother's ears, and I wonder how long it is since she last saw him, and I think of her thinking of him every hour of every day. So one of the things you can do with a comic is you can really meet someone, and that's got an interesting resonance when talking about creating narratives of people in precarious situations, people who are undocumented, or people who are about to, well, the situation in the UK is that up until we left Europe, in any European country where an asylum seeker tries to claim refuge, they can be deported back to the first safe country they came from in Europe. So they have to stay under the radar. They have to stay without medical attention. They have to stay without being arrested until they can get to the country where they are choosing to claim asylum. So So you can't make a film of a refugee in Calais chatting around or take photos of them, because then that could be used to reject their asylum claim if they make it to the UK. But what I could do is I could draw comics, and you can meet people through comics. We all squeeze into Hosha's hut, kick our shoes off, and there's only one place to go, a softly padded 7-foot square space. This is Alaz, he lives here too. So that's two grown men in an 8-foot shack. They each have a sliver of broken mirror tacked up to shave by. It's well insulated. It would be warmish, except we have to leave the door open to let in some light. I'll make you lunch. It's not a question. Hosha busies himself in his 18-inch kitchen, knocking two eggs together and tipping them into a pan. The sadness temporarily ebbs from his face in the process. Welcoming, cooking, sharing. You can tell this fits with his sense of how things should be in the world. We play the let's show each other our families on our phones game. Hosha's turn. The contrast with Hosha's current view is stark. What must it be like to feel homesick for somewhere it's not safe for you to be? So, this is the making a cup of tea and putting two enormous spoonfuls of sugar in each one frame. Hosha, how are you? How am I? I don't know what I say. He doesn't even want to be here. The plan is to join his uncle in Croydon, but the longer it takes, the more often he fails to catch that elusive lorry, the harder it becomes to even try. There is a big European meeting at the end of the month. They will work out how to help refugees, yes? The enormity, the immediacy of the problem is so clear to Hosha that it seems obvious that politicians must want to help. But Hosha, refugees can't vote. Didn't you know? Immigrants are always feared, always vilified. They hate you, Hosha. They think you're a terrorist. That's what we don't say. So it was ethically problematic drawing this cartoon. Like I deliberately draw myself as slightly dim in the narrative. And partly that's a device so I can get some exposition in there. It's like I can be the character that is me, can be wandering around going, oh, what do we do now? Well, like here I am in a kebab shop in Brighton saying, oh, is it the Calais jungle? I was there, I was volunteering. And this guy's probably thinking, just buy the kebab, please, come on. So it's not a fucking day trip. What are we doing? Swanning around Calais, congratulating ourselves on a fabulous relief effort. It's not about a bunch of white middle-class do-gooders off on a charity holiday. And particularly as an English woman and a working, not a middle-class English woman, I do feel like there's this... this tradition of the lady of the manor just comes down and distributes largesse to the deserving poor. And like a little bit of what people do when they take a relief effort to, or send relief or charity to people abroad is still part of that continuum. It's still not addressing the fundamental inequality of why there is rich and poor. You wonder if we're doing the right thing. Our relief effort is just, I'm sorry, our relief effort is just a band-aid, isn't it? They made me change that because apparently nobody knows what a sticking plaster is outside of England. Only in that it would hurt a lot of people if you suddenly removed it. And there were situations where I was in Calais where I felt compromised by my role. I went there as an activist and as a volunteer. But this is a situation where goods are being given out in the marquee behind me. And I'm standing holding the line from this guy who's trying to get past, and I suddenly feel like, hang on, I've become the border guard. And it's not a story, this is reality. Now, because I went as an activist, I mean, I did draw sketches of people individually as an actor from one human to another, but in general, I didn't bounce into Calais jungle going, hey, it's okay, the cartoonist is here. So I didn't, people had no way of knowing I was going to make a representation of the events based on my experiences. And this genuinely happened. My friend Jet did say, I'm going to tell you something and I want it to remain confidential. And I said, I won't draw a cartoon about it, I promise. And I have subsequently drawn a cartoon about it. I mean, it was also reported in the newspaper, so it's not like I'm actually breaking confidentiality, but still. So I want to have a look at some of the other ways that people have approached stories of migration in ways that are possibly more like they're kind of ethically less confused. Like this is positivenegatives.org, and they just do awesome fact-based comics. And one of the things that they do is that they find people who, they find migrants and people in vulnerable situations, and then they assign an artist to them, and they give them editorial control over what the artist does. And that's what's lacking from my representations. Instead, I went away, I made representations of people, fairly honestly, and based on my interactions with them. And then my only way of seeking consent for it was to just like friend them on Facebook, and then just like send them some pictures and then see if I got a little thumbs up or not. So obviously positive negatives, they're working from the outset in the place where they're giving the subject of the cartoon the editorial control of the editorial process. I want to highlight the work of Carrie Fransman. She's done some excellent work for Positive Negatives and elsewhere, where she's looking at the structural wider drivers of migration and refugees and asylum. So that's really, she's got some awesome artwork. These are people I invited to the book launch for Threads as well. They're like, they did presentations as well. And Olivier Kugler's, oh my God, like his illustration is to die for. It possibly makes me want to break my own pencils. But he goes off and he does similar sorts of graphic reportage. But because he walks into the situation from the outset, and he does say, I'm a cartoonist, I'm here, I've been paid. He comes in like a journalist. So people know that what they're saying to him is going to be recorded in cartoons. And I like the way that he's gives people all the voice in his comic is from the subject of the people. So again, it's very moving, it's very effective, but it very much prioritizes the people it's talking about. However, this is my talk, so I'm also going to talk about all the things that I had previously done, all the books that I'd previously written, and the way that they feed into what I encountered in Calais. So if you like, it's kind of like, I'm a bit of a weirdo, and here is all the stuff that I brought to the table, just as a kind of a way of talking about what I saw in a bit more depth. So I used to live in a tree, which is a great one to drop into conversation at parties. And I wrote a book about it. We made road process camps to try and prevent roads and open cast mines from being built in the 1990s. And so I'm used to living outside, and all these questions that people ask about living outside. And this is my friend Donna, and that is a 70-foot drop. And I raised a family living in a truck, and this is my son in a bucket. And so there were aspects of life in Calais, which was like not unfamiliar. Like I could see families living in fields, and I did know something about that. However, the difference was that I did it by choice, okay? And there were aspects, and again, the contrast then was really quite apparent. I really see what it means to have nothing. There's a fire, but no axe to make kindling. There's no grate, just some loose tent poles hammered flat. They've been given a camping kettle, but the plastic handle melts in the flames. A candle, but nothing to put it in. Its flame gutters in the wind. And I met people, like I met children, and the conversations I was having was like, what do you want to do? And this guy, kid goes, he wants to be a school teacher. And suddenly I realized like, that might not happen. He might not get to go to school. He's in Northern France. He's 45 minutes away from the UK. It's really quite stunning. So I've written a book about breastfeeding. Actually, this picture of me driving a truck while breastfeeding a baby isn't in the book because apparently it gives the wrong image about child safety, but still. I was wearing a hat that said Mother Trucker at the time. So I get breastfeeding into any book I ever write. Not everyone in Calais even wants to go to England. They're eternally propelled onwards in a desperate search for somewhere less hostile than every other European country they encounter. I gaze into the flames. I doubt they'll find it. Actually, there was a sort of infant feeding aspect to what we were doing out there, because my friend Jet, who we were traveling with, is a midwife, and she, I was handing out formula to women who needed it. And so I make some little representations of that as well. So I've written a book called Bump, which is about pregnancy and birth. And that, again, was directly relevant to Jet's work out in, this is in Dunkirk, which is another camp, which was like a little bit further north of Calais. Jet makes tentative first contact with a pregnant woman in the camp. Most pregnant refugees have had no antenatal care. If Jet can build a relationship of trust, she can encourage them to seek any help they might need. The baby will be born here in Dunkirk. I have everything ready. The floor here is cold and wet. We must find you some carpet. And this is just, it's not in the book, but it's just a photo of the warehouse where we were consolidating the stuff that we were taking out to people. And I just had to stop and take a snapshot of this. It's like, this is 2015, and we're talking about people giving birth in completely unsafe conditions, reliant on donated out-of-date nappy cream. This is just insane. Police brutality, I've had a lot of experience of going, being part of protests, putting my body on the line, again, by choice. But when we got over to Calais, it wasn't us who the police brutality was being visited on. We had to be super, super careful and nice to all police officers that we met, because if we pissed them off, it wasn't us who was going to get beaten up. I'm sorry, can I smoke? Do you mind if I wind the window down? No. We found out what happened when the police came through the camp this morning. Remember that family I told you about? The single mum with the twins. Incidentally, she didn't actually have twins. I changed that aspect to preserve her privacy. The police stormed into her home and threw her stuff all over the floor. She was begging them, please don't photograph my children. And they slapped her 3 times in the face. Now, I had to put 3 pictures in of her being slapped, but if I'd done that as a double page spread, then you would have ended up with a gutter through the middle of the central page. So I made 4. And I'm really pleased that I gave her the ability to look back in this situation, that I gave her some agency. So I've had experience of evictions and things getting torn down and trashed, and that is what happened to the camp in Calais. So there's obvious visual things that I'm drawing the same old cartoon again. I can't explain the noise of the machines, screeching, tearing, ear splitting, clanging, the jaws disgorged debris into massive metal skips. And the rows of police, like robots, like insects. A man holds a mirror up to their faces so they can see what they've become. They don't react. How must it feel having lost everything before to lose everything again? And this is from a photo of a guy at the point when he was evicted. And again, I'm pleased that I managed to take his protest and record it in a way where it will live on a bit more, that his message will be heard. So some of my books address indirectly some of the reasons why we have refugees, well, directly and indirectly. This is why we've got refugees, cause of militarism and war and climate change. I wrote a book about climate change in 2001, back before it was fashionable, guys. And in it, I've got these 3 central characters in the book, and one of them is like this fat cat businessman, and it goes, refugees, they're not coming here. And then I point out that in the book that the UK is vulnerable to climate change, and that our climate, if the Gulf Stream is messed up, our climate could become radically colder. Oh gosh, in that case, I'll have to consider relocating abroad. But that'll make you a refugee. Oh no. It makes me an expatriate. So yeah, okay. So that's why we've got refugees, because of this kind of scenario. And I've also written a book called Red Rosa, which is about Rosa Luxemburg, who's a 19th century revolutionary socialist. And in it, I kind of do this thing where I kind of explain the Marxist critique of capitalism from first principles. And this is a Luxembourg quote. All humanity groans with frightful suffering under the yoke of a blind social power, capital, that it has itself unconsciously created. The underlying purpose of every social form of production, the satisfaction of society's needs, is turned completely on its head. Production is no longer for the sake of people. Production for the sake of profit becomes the law all over the earth. And Luxembourg drew, she was talking about globalization 50 years before the term had been coined, and she was also talking about the military-industrial complex. She was like really ahead of her time. Obviously before we had the words military-industrial complex. This force is the only solution available to capitalism. The accumulation of capital employs force as a permanent weapon. And Luxembourg was a refugee. She was born in Poland, which was under Tsarist Russian control, and she was targeted for her political beliefs and the fact that she was a tiny, limping, Jewish woman with a gold tooth, which would have made it pretty bloody obvious as a revolutionary socialist. So she escaped and went to Germany. But because, which is actually quite an eye-opener, that all she had to do was jump in the back of a cart and then she was in Germany. I think she had to hide under some hay. Do you know what I mean? It's like, what we're seeing is a crisis now of people being unable to move, being stuck, being shot, being starved on borders, is entirely an artificial construction, and it's very, very much a late 20th century phenomenon. So all the way through the book, I include these negative messages, including that one that I referenced earlier and I put them on mobile phones, kind of like as a commentary. And one of the one, some of them are comments that have been made in direct response to my work, and some of them I just trawl the sewer that is YouTube comments sections to try and find more anti-refugee sentiment. So if you give refuge to anyone that needs it, where are these never-ending resources, space, jobs, homes going to come from? And I think it's worth saying that while the incredible inequality, global inequality that we have as a result of capitalism and imperialism is why we have got this migrant crisis combined with the military industrial and climate change stuff. Also, in its own terms, it makes no sense to waste people. Okay, so obviously the conventional narrative is, oh, you have to wait for health treatment, you can't get children to school of your choosing, why not help the homeless here? But if we actually let people move from where they cannot work productively where we can, to where they can, the whole world benefits. Mathematical modelling shows that removing all national barriers to migration would double global gross domestic product. So there isn't anything humans could do that would benefit the economy more. It doesn't make sense in its own terms, capitalism, to not allow migration. So, hang on, I need to go forward to find out what I'm talking about here. Oh yeah. And the other thing that I brought to the situation in Calais, as well as being an activist and a tree protester and a birth worker and all the rest of it, is I was an artist. And surprisingly, there was an art centre in Calais where a woman called Sue had set up a little kind of like drawing place. Do you want to do some painting? The guy looked like me, to me like I was mad. And then the next minute, his face changed. So all these are pictures that she sent me, photos of pictures that people drew. Loves, flowers, birds, hearts. There are a lot of flags, a lot of homelands. They miss their homes. They need to fly the flag. And I've done some reference to the ways that representations of migration and of asylum have been made by other minority world Western artists. But what I haven't really talked about is the art that results when people make their own representations of what they've been through. So obviously you've got Persepolis and you've got Mouse, which is like a pretty first-hand representation, just like one level down with his son. But there's also a guy called Majid Adeen. Yeah, now he was in that Calais jungle art studio. Now he's an Iranian. He had been imprisoned. I don't exactly find out why by the Iranian government, but he managed to escape, I think, at the end of his prison sentence. I met him in Calais. He made it to the UK, and he was like an artist and an animator in Iran. And then he came over to the UK, and this is him with Elton John, right? This is how random this gets. Okay, he won a YouTube competition to create a video for an Elton John song. And I want to show you his artwork. I mean, it's excellent, okay? It's so excellent that when I invited him to my book launch, I made him go last, because you don't want to follow this, okay? So I'm going to stop screen sharing, and then you guys are going to watch the video, and then we're going to do the Q&A. So you'll need to think about questions as well, because that'd be really great. She packed my bags like light. 0 hour, 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. So much, I miss my wife. It's lonely out in space on such a timeless flight. Touchdown brings me round again to find I'm not the man they think I am at home. Oh no, 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 I'm a rocket man. Rocket man, burning out his fuse out of here alone. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time till touchdown brings me round again. Fact is cold as hell, and there's no one there to raise them. If you did, and all the science I don't understand, it's just my job. I'm not the man they think I am at home.
think it's gonna be a long, long time. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time. And I think it's gonna be a long, long time.